It's an issue 117 years in the making. Puerto Rico's status and relationship with the United States. Should Puerto Rico be admitted as the 51st state of the United States? Puerto Rico is a U.S. territory or commonwealth. Under the current status, Puerto Ricans are U.S. citizens who pay taxes, mostly Social Security and Medicare taxes, but do not pay federal income taxes. Puerto Ricans can and have been fighting in the U.S. military, but they cannot vote for President of the United States or in any other federal elections. They also have zero voting power in the U.S. House and Senate. Former Governor Luis Fortuño is a pro-statehood leader who, despite losing his re-election last November, is still pushing the issue. Governor, thanks for joining us.
It's my pleasure. Thank you.
So you think Puerto Rico should become a state. Why?
Well, for almost 120 years, we have been part of the nation. And actually, we have been natural-born American citizens since 1917, fought in every war, actually proportionally speaking, in greater numbers than most states since 1917. We're proud of being Americans, Hispanics as well, and Puerto Ricans. And we contribute to the nation. We want to continue contributing to the nation. But we also want to partake in the decision-making process on issues that actually affect our daily life. As we speak, Congress is discussing what are we going to do with Syria. Well, you know, a lot of Americans of Puerto Rican descent serve in the military. And we cannot elect our commander-in-chief unless we move to one of the 50 states. That ought to change. And actually, if you were to move to Puerto Rico, you will lose your voting rights. And you will pay taxes down in Puerto Rico, not here. But still, it just doesn't make any sense. We ought to decide this, whether we're in or we are out. But we cannot live in limbo forever.
You know, the unemployment rate in Puerto Rico is 13.5%. Current Governor Alejandro Garcia Padilla says that if Puerto Rico becomes a state, it will be bad for business and the island will turn into a, quote, Latin American ghetto. True?
Well, there are 50 actually examples of why states are successful. And there's one example, Puerto Rico, of why territories are no longer successful. And if you were to invest either in one of the 50 states or a U.S. territory, where do you feel more comfortable investing? It is clear that it will be in one of the 50 states. And that's another reason why we should become a state.
You know, on November 6th, let's get to this vote, this referendum vote, controversial vote. On November 6th, Puerto Rico held a referendum vote. 54% of Puerto Ricans said they were not satisfied with the current Commonwealth status. Of the 1.3 million voters, 61% supported statehood. But people say the vote was unfair because the option to stay as a territory was not listed. So 500,000 people actually left that question blank. Governor Fortuño, was the November vote fair in your estimation?
Of course, I followed exactly what actually Congress has suggested we do for a long time. There were two questions. The first question was whether we wanted to remain a territory or not. So the question was there. And actually, 54% of voters stated that they do not want to remain a territory. The same people that elected Governor Alejandro Garcia Padilla voted this way. So we have to respect the will of the people. That's the American way. In the second question, however, there were three options. And those are the options that actually, under different administrations, Republicans and Democrats, have been stated as the only options that are constitutionally viable. That's either statehood, independence, or free association. Actually, we just had a hearing in the U.S. Senate about this issue, and it was clear on both sides of the aisle that there is no other option if we want a permanent decision on this issue than those three. So that's exactly what we did. Had the voters decided they wanted to remain a territory, then the second vote would not have happened.
Okay, that's fair enough. But so you're saying that the current status as a Commonwealth was not listed as an option because it was never listed before?
No. It was in the first question. The first question was whether we wanted to remain as we are or not. And 54% said, no, we do not want to remain as we are.
Okay.
So that was the question. It was posed to the voters, the same people that elected Governor Padilla.
Governor Fortuño, if this is such an important issue, as we are all made to believe it is for Puerto Ricans by Puerto Ricans themselves, why does the government keep issuing non-binding referendum votes that hold no weight and seem to just punt the political football on the issue to the next governor in power?
Well, it's very simple. It is Congress, only Congress, that has the authority to act upon this, to act upon the future of the territories. However, there was actually a request during the last few years for a congressionally sanctioned vote, and that never happened. Congress, actually the House, voted in favor of this bill, but the Senate never got around to seeing it. So the administration here, Obama administration, suggested that we hold our own referendum, and we just filed exactly what Washington suggested we do. So we'd rather have a federally sanctioned referendum, but if that didn't happen, the second option was the best, you know, the second best option was exactly what we did, and that's exactly what the White House suggested we do. So we're just following what's being suggested by Washington.
All right, so based on the results of the referendum, Pedro Pierluisi, who's Puerto Rico's non-voting member of Congress and a pro-statehood leader, introduced the Puerto Rican statehood bill in Congress in May. The bill proposes a federally authorized final vote in Puerto Rico. Do you want Puerto Rico to be admitted as a state of the United States? Yes or no? It seems like a simple question.
Yeah.
You're facing opposition from the most prominent Boricuas, though, in Congress, Representative Luis Gutierrez and Nidia Velasquez, saying it's flawed and that all options should be presented to voters. Your response to that?
Well, it's so interesting. First of all, you left out Jose Serrano and Raul and then Idaho's congressman. So we have four Puerto Ricans with voting rights. Two tend to favor what we're doing, two don't. The two that don't favor it, it just happens that they live in a state, that their constituents actually can vote for the commander-in-chief, that they have full rights and obligations as an American citizen, whereas we don't. So if they think what we have is so nice and so positive, why don't they move down to the island?
Well, I mean, do you think this bill will seriously even get past a congressional committee? I mean, you said it yourself. It's really in the hands of Congress. It's been in the hands of Congress. Do you see it moving forward, this particular bill?
Well, in the last term, the House voted for it. It was the Senate that never got around to taking care of this. And this will require, I would say, presidential leadership. I believe the White House will have to lead this effort in order to because that's the way it has happened in some of the previous territories that became states. And, you know, in the last 100 or so years, we have had Hawaii, Alaska, New Mexico, Arizona, that have actually walked the same pathway we have. And the White House has a major role in pushing this forward, and certainly Congress has to act upon it. But at the end of the day, we're talking about 3.7 million American citizens. Should we, in the 21st century, continue to have a situation whereby we have a set of citizens that don't have the same rights as the rest, and actually those rights are determined solely by where they live? By moving to any of the 50 states, we gain those rights. If you were to move down to Puerto Rico, you lose those rights. That doesn't make any sense.
Give me the truth here and what you think is going to happen next. I mean, do you seriously think this bill will move forward? And if not, what do you think Congress will do, if anything, to finally get this done? I mean, do you see an end to this debate that's been happening for over 100 years now?
Well, I certainly hope so. I am realistic right now. What Congress is debating certainly is the Syrian situation. It has to debate whether to raise or not the national debt ceiling, what to do about the budget. We're less than a month away from the beginning of the new fiscal year. So we have a number of significant issues that are before Congress that have to be addressed.
Governor, do you have a timeline, perhaps, a thought? I mean, in your mind, any estimation at all? Would you like to see this in the next 10 years, 15 years? What should people really be holding out there, putting their hopes on out there?
We would certainly hope that something happens during this Congress. So it's either this year or the next year. If that were not to happen, certainly, it will be a major disappointment. And in that sense, I would presume that our non-voting member of Congress, Pedro Pierluisi, may refile the bill. The bill today has over 120 co-sponsors. It's a bipartisan bill. This is an American issue. It's not a Puerto Rican issue. It's an American issue that has to be addressed.
Pierluisi says that he'll take the issue to the United Nations if Congress punts. Would you join him on that?
I respect his opinion. This has to be addressed and decided by us in the United States, and it is Congress that has the authority, the legal authority, to solve this once and for all.
Okay. And, you know, the White House has proposed spending $2.5 million on another plebiscite vote. Obama says that he'll support whatever the majority of Puerto Ricans support. You're just saying right now that you think it's a lack of leadership, or perhaps Obama really needs to get involved. Is he doing enough? Isn't he doing exactly what other presidents have done, which is just wait and see what the Puerto Ricans have to say themselves?
Well, it's that's an easy way out. I can tell you that President Reagan actually was pretty adamant and open about this. And he felt very strongly that this had to be addressed. I can tell you by the same token that at the end of the Clinton administration, he opened up and he started providing leadership on this issue as well. So we have had some presidents in the past that have provided leadership. Many have not.
So you specifically want him to do what, though? Because ultimately it has to go through Congress. Do you want him to fill out the rest of that sentence for me?
Sure. I would love to see the White House actually get behind the bill that already has over 120 co-sponsors on both sides of the aisle and push for it to get through the House and the Senate. But, for example, the Senate just had hearings on it, and the White House didn't send anyone on behalf of the administration. I can tell you that under President Bush in the last term, the White House did send someone to speak on behalf of the administration, and that person was pretty direct and open about where the administration was.
You know, there are more Puerto Ricans living in the United States than in Puerto Rico, nearly 5 million to about 3.7 million. But those who criticize the bill say Puerto Ricans living in the U.S. should not be allowed to vote on the island's status. I mean, what's your thought on that? You know, Representative Luis Gutierrez and Nidia Velasquez, you know, they sent the letter asking Congress to oppose the bill. I mean, do you believe Puerto Ricans living in the U.S. should have the right to vote on this important matter?
No, this is a states' rights issue. And at the end of the day, we should follow states' rules and laws in terms of determining who votes where. And normally, you vote only one state or jurisdiction, and that's where you reside. So if you move to Florida, you should vote in Florida, not in Puerto Rico, and vice versa.
You know, if Puerto Rico were a state, I'm curious to ask you this. If Puerto Rico were a state, do you think it could have made your 4 years there as governor, your attempts to help Puerto Rico's economy easier or harder?
Much easier, because we were doing the right thing. I cut our budget by almost 20%. I started flattening our tax system and lowering our rates, contrary to what has happened in the last year. And actually, for the first time in 6 years, and at the end of 2011 and all of 2012, the economy got into positive territory. It was certainly not enough, but we were moving in the right direction. Had we been part of the nation, I am convinced, you know, as a full-fledged state, I am convinced that it would have been much easier to attract investment and create jobs in Puerto Rico.
You know, people are all about the bottom line. So if you look at the numbers with the bottom line in unemployment, unemployment peaked during your 4 years there in 2010 to 16.4%. Puerto Rico is still looking at an unemployment rate of 13.5%. I'm curious if when you look back now and what you're seeing, do you consider what you've done? You talked about your cuts, but at the end of the day, there's still a lot of people without work in Puerto Rico, Governor.
Well, I agree, and it's a tragedy. Having said that, however, we had more people working at the time than now, because you can not only look at unemployment rates, you have to look at how many people are actually seeking a job. And so we had more people actually working during those 4 years than now. So obviously we were doing something right. By the same token, housing sales were up, car sales were up, retail sales were up. So in that sense, we were doing what was right. Right now, it's exactly the opposite, and there are less people working today than a year ago.
It's been a few months since you were in office. I really wanted to ask you, what have you been doing, and what's the future looking like for Governor Luis Fortuño? Are we thinking perhaps run at a U.S. Office position here?
I'm just an old town lawyer. I'm working as a lawyer again. That's what I did for most of my professional life. And that's exactly what I'm doing. I've admitted to the practice of law in Washington, and I'm doing exactly what I used to do. I'm a corporate lawyer working on transactions.
Any thoughts of running for office any other day, any day within the next maybe 10 years? You've thought about it?
No, I really don't have any plans on running for office. I plan on making sure that I can I can pay for my kids' education. I have three kids in college right now.
Yeah, that's a task everyone's trying to get get their hands around. So, well, anyway, Governor, thank you so much for joining us here at Fox News Latino. I very much appreciate your time on such an important topic, and we'll be following up throughout this year and next, hopefully, to see what this bill and perhaps where this issue goes from here. So, again, thank you, Governor. And for more from Fox News Latino, make sure to go to foxnewslatino.com. In New York, Bryan Llenas.